Welcome to my presentation about energy efficiency optimization for offshore oil and gas installations. My name is Jürgen Weichenberger, and I'm working in Schneider's AI Hub, where we are building next generation AI solutions for our customers. As we are looking today into our solutions, I will first give you a quick glance about who we are. So we are a global company all around the world with about an equal distribution, 128,000 people, or newly 140,000 after the full acquisition of Aviva. And we are delivering a full stack of applications from data generation all the way in the cloud and back. And what is our most important element hereby is to empower all to make the most of our energy and resources, bridging the progress and sustainability for all. So we call it Life is On at Schneider. So our mission is to be the digital partner for sustainability and efficiency across all the industries, including the oil and gas industry, or newly called the energy industry. So what are we having today? So when we're looking in, I give you a brief definition of what is AIML so that we're all on the same page. I will get you through what is the energy and utility opportunity, why are we doing all of that, give you some context of AI and exceptional technology, and then we are hopping on a real-world example which we just have implemented, and at the end I will open it for question and answers. So what is artificial intelligence? So it's definitely not new. We have artificial since the early 1950s, where the first form of neural networks were invented. So we even didn't count the invention of linear regression or logistic regression, because this was mathematical models which were there even earlier. Over the course of the next five centuries, we have developed more and more models to give us more versatility. And we have developed from a pure statistically machine learning approach into more and more learning and generative approaches. Today, you will hear a lot about generative AI. You will hear about large language models. ChatGPT, GPT-4 is all over the place. All of that helps us to be better and more efficient in what we are doing every day. And the transition from simple to complex and back to simple models is what allows us to do complex tasks like what we're seeing today. To see you that we are not the first ones, and we'll also be the last ones. Siemens has already given a very clear example 5 years ago. Artificial intelligence can drop nitrogen oxide levels by 20%. Google's DeepMind has done a great deal of work, and DeepMind itself is continuously evolving and improving. It makes our world safer and sounder. So now, what is the energy opportunity? So in simple terms, it's the combination of emerging technologies on the one side, such as then distributed energy resources, analytics, and distributed ledgers like blockchain. AI encompasses all of this to help us making the use of energy more efficient. And we have three main components. First, we need powerful intelligence to balance the grids. Here at ETAP, at the Convergence, we hear a lot about the management of power. Hence, demand and supply, the flow of power, negotiate the right actions, being self-healing. So if you have a breakdown of one component in the network, you don't want to have a full network breakdown. You want to be self-sustained, and you want to move forward. You also want to be open for new products, for new services, specifically when you look in low voltage grids today, the introduction of prosumers. So the way to turn the flow of energy around from a one-way direction all the way to the consumer, now back from the consumer, becomes a producer with its PVs or wind, and then this energy has to go somewhere. We need, as I said, be smart in demand management. Which energy resources are available at which point in time? And at the end, we need to protect our infrastructure. Infrastructure is something which is grown over many years and is very vulnerable. Again, artificial intelligence can help you here to better understand how much life has your equipment left, how much you can do with it, how much you can stress it before it will finally break down for good. So all of this are really critical insights where artificial intelligence can significantly help us. So what does it mean, renewables management? We all believe energy is there. So we never really challenge where it's coming from. But when we are looking now that we get a whole new energy mix, we just had over the weekend Germany's exit from nuclear power. So they need to produce all the energy they need from fossil fuel-based power generation or hydropower generation or renewable power generation. So now specifically renewables, you depend on wind and sun. And you can use some exotics like tide powers and geothermal power stations, but they're widely in Europe not available. So you see, managing these assets becomes critical to have consistent power at any point in time. When we're looking now at demand and supply management, to manage the supply, you need to understand the demand. Demand is driven by energy efficiency. So a huge leapfrog forward will come if we improve more efficient energy solutions, more efficient consumers. This goes along with more efficient energy management systems. It means we understand where the energy has to go at any point in time. And this also comes then with disaster recovery and all of these elements to make this way more stable and reliable. And now when we're looking at the infrastructure management, old school ways of managing infrastructure was we did our condition-based maintenance. We did some preventative maintenance by greasing and oiling stuff, topping up the oil levels and transformers, maintaining our breakers, do wire management, stuff like that. Today, with the wealth of data we have available, we can do things very, very differently. We can literally real-time monitor asset condition. We can, in real-time, predict what is the remaining asset lifetime under various load conditions. We can predict new strategies of how to manage all of the equipment in the right way. As you can see here, digital asset management is now leapfrogging the conventional and classic ways on how to manage energy. And that brings us a bit to why we are now deploying artificial intelligence. One of the biggest things is, one of the biggest things we first need to address to make artificial intelligence work is removing bias. Unfortunately, a lot of data sets are biased by human opinion. If we train our artificial intelligence solution with that bias, we will have huge struggles to make it work because the AI is only that good that which person has trained it. The next thing is we have to build trust. Many people believe artificial intelligence is per se right. This only holds true for the departments who build it and who understand it. When we're going out in the control rooms of power stations and grids, on oil and gas platforms in this specific case, these guys don't believe what a machine says. They trust gauges, they trust experience, they trust haptics. They put a hand on a housing of a generator, and if they feel the vibration of the shaft, they don't know it's good. If the AI then tells them, keep running, it will just hang on and go good. It's a very hard time for these people to understand and trust it. So you need to build the trust. You need to take these people along the lines. And that also brings you to design thinking. So you cannot just randomly build artificial intelligence solutions and expect that they're getting being accepted by the people on the shop floor, and even more importantly, that they automatically produce value. So it's very important here to get through the thought process with the people who push the buttons, who turn the wheels and make things happen. Convince them and give them the tools they need to run the operations in a better fashion. And that means take the random tasks away from them and free them up to be more efficient. And when we're seeing this now, it leads to what we would call an emerge and convergence of emerging technologies and energy developments. As I said, we have distributed energy resources, producers, consumers, transferables. We have more sensors and IEDs who help us out. And we have modern demand management. And on the other side, we have artificial intelligence. We have distributed ledgers in form of blockchains. And we have robotics, which allow us to take people off the critical areas, and we can create this convergence. And when we're now looking at that is, what have we effectively done? We haven't. When we're looking at an offshore oil and gas installation, we're using lots of different types of compressors, which require tons of energy. So when you take a field like Block 5 of Al Shaheen, you have 35 platforms, but only two of the 35 platforms are capable of producing power and supplying the entire network to make it work. So when we're looking here in the challenge, we had 17 air compressors, 16 gas compressors in there, which together consume 470 megawatts of power. So how can you produce all the power in the first instance? And secondly, the more important question, do you really need to run all this hardware at any point in time? So what it requires to next to understanding electrically powered distribution, you also need to encompass production, because this equipment doesn't exist there for fun to just eat energy. It has a real purpose. And so what we need to achieve here is, how can we make it run in the most efficient way, and how can we run the right quantities of equipment at the right point in time? So it leads us that we need to combine the process world, the production plan, with the power generation, so with my distributed energy resources, to get those melted down and make the right decisions. So because we need how much energy we need at any point in time, we need how much compressed gases we need for artificial lift at any point in time, because we know how much flow we need to generate. So we create this cascade and then dynamically optimize it to say, okay, we run so many gas turbines at any point in time. We hold so many gas turbines in hot standby that we can just chip them in when we need them. And we know that we actually can shut down three or four gas turbines because we don't need them at all at this point in time. So we can improve maintenance and we can reduce the wear and tear. So what we achieved in this project, by applying a modern artificial intelligence-based system combined with based on a multi-agent system, which allows us to dynamically model all the DERs in the system. It allows us also to model communication in form of real-time demand and supply conversations, but also real-time demand and supply overload situations, where one of the players in this game can say, I'm full. I can't do any more. If you put more on me, you just blow me up. So he can tell the system, slow down, give me the time to breathe and get rid of my backlog before we move it on. And that is controlled by AI, which creates the scenarios. Says, can I redirect energy? What can I do to keep the balance and that they're keeping the barrels out? And what I achieved here was, by having all this modern tech, we get a nearly 9% reduction in energy consumption. And you can imagine that's about 40 megawatts per day less power use. And we saved 114 hours of equipment runtime per month. So it's a better part of 4 days of not running equipment. So when you think over the years, it's 48 days more equipment life. You can translate it in money. It's a heck of a shitload of money. Sorry for my English here, but so that is how we made it And the other very important part was not just trust any sort of form of sense or reading, also factor in how you can actively control it. So you see, AI gives you way more than just some insights. It allows you to get from insights to actions, to outcomes, or to continuous improvement. So you will often hear today the cycle of reinforcement learning, but that's part of another lecture or presentation to get you in the world of that. But I just want to show you here with AI, we get 9% less energy consumption. We get 114 hours more life per month from this equipment. So over the year, 480 megawatts of power saved. It means way less carbon and on. So that's what I want to show you here in a quick presentation, what we have achieved and done. So from here on, any questions? Thank you very much.